Okay. The topic of the presentation is the evolution of resuscitation, and we are going to see some very exciting images of the past and a few of the present. And we are going to talk about facts and myths about the history of resuscitation. Time to demonstrate my Greek dancing skills to entertain you before we are ready. Opa, yes. Okay, scholarly work about resuscitation is extensive on several aspects, but very rare references we see in terms of history. If you go to the scientific database called Medline and you use the terms cardiopulmonary resuscitation or CPR or resuscitation, you will see thousands of published scholarly work about the subject, but not so many about history. And we need to undertake a more careful study to be able to see what's going on in terms of history and be able to answer several research questions. So the questions of this scholarly attempt was to answer to all this. Was the resuscitation of an apparently dead person always the same? Or did it change through the years? Were resuscitation methods always scientifically established? Or it was a matter of experience? If something was successful, we thought that it is correct, and then we kept continuing doing it. How was resuscitation performed through the centuries? And was any equipment used during these resuscitation attempts? Or it was just one man is helping another? Are there any facts and myths associated with the evolution of resuscitation internationally? Because sometimes authors copy previous authors without realizing that what the original authors have written is not correct. Why should we undertake a study like this? To overview the evolution and development of resuscitation, to identify the progress in the thinking of on emergency response, to discover whether the development of resuscitation methods has concerned scientists and emergency professionals, and to attempt an historical synthesis of the most important aspects in first aid and emergency care. So the aim of this work was to review the literature, identifying various resuscitation methods that have been suggested and used, and to evaluate the content. The method was a comprehensive literature review of peer-reviewed journal articles, magazine articles, and academic and professional textbooks. So we see here in the very long time ago, centuries ago, the book says that Prophet Elijah gave breath and life to an apparently dead young boy. So he blew air onto the face of the boy, and this is how the boy miraculously survived. So people believe that this is actually a rough demonstration of resuscitation. Egyptians, on the other hand, turn upside down the apparently lifeless body of a person, shaking it to try to revive this person. This was a technique commonly used at this period of time. And then on a later stage of history, we use the heat method, in order to reward the apparently dead person. The flagellation method, as I said yesterday, was quite violent. And of course, every method that you are going to see from now on was proved to be successful if the person was not dead. So the people were apparently dead, but they were not really dead. So if someone with all this violence that was applied on his body used to come up, they thought that the technique is successful, and they kept continuing using it. In the bellows method, as you see here, they use this specific instrumentation to blow air into the casualty's mouth. Apparently, some of these methods could have some success. This is quite strange, and many life-saving organizations around the world, as well as first aid organizations, usually make jokes with this method. Because as you can see here, we blow smoke into the anus of the casualty. And if that worked for some people who were not dead, then they kept doing it. It was just, I am copying what I have seen you doing successfully. And then it was the inversion method. They used to tie the casualty upside down, pull and with a rope. So it was up and down at the tree. This would generate the inhalation, exhalation phases of our breathing. And then there was the barrel method, where we were rolling the casualty on a barrel, and then this could simulate the inhalation, exhalation stage of breathing again. And then there is another different kind of method, opposite to the heat method that we saw before. It was the Russian cooling method. They used to cover the body of the person with ice, and they thought this could work. The trotting horse method. In other depictions, we see the same thing. Instead of horse, we have a bull. Possibly they might have used it with several animals. So during the trotting, the casualty on the back could have a phase of inhalation, exhalation. This method was abandoned, though, at some stage of the life-saving and emergency history, because the horses at the beach created a lot of, you know, and they were dirtying the beach. So they abandoned this method because the beach should stay clean. In the Leroy method, you see that the pressure is applied on the chest and abdomen, and then we release the pressure to trigger inspiration. In the thank you very much. 1831, we are pulling cloth. Two rescuers are doing this, which is around the chest of the casualty, to try again to simulate inhalation, exhalation. In the Marshall Hall method, 1856, we see that the rescuer is standing the casualty on the side, rolling on the back. Sylvester method, 1861, the victim on back, arms over the head, and there the rescuer is compressing the arms on the chest to simulate the exhalation, and then raises the arm up to simulate inhalation. In the Howard method, 1871, The rescuer is straddled on the victim, exerting pressure on upper abdomen and lower chest for low expiration, and then is releasing the pressure to cause inspiration. Francis' method, you see, some methods have similarities and some others differences are completely unique. Here they raise and lower the casualty. So again, we have the two stages of breathing. In the Van Labordet method, which is something unusual and different to what we saw before, you see here a different technique. I believe that this is quite similar to what we see nurses doing to newborn babies after the birth. I have seen something similar, but not exactly the same, when I was in the operation theater during a birth and the baby was coughing. It was something similar to this. So we can see that these have started in 1894. It's not new knowledge. In the Vance Brosset, we use this instrumentation to place the casualty on the top, and again use the hands of the casualty up and down for the two stages of breathing. In the Saffer method, we just push the back of the casualty and then release the pressure for inhalation, exhalation. And here, different technique, 1916, we use an instrumentation to apply pressure on the chest. Well now, like what we have seen with the swimwears happening, we had the old-fashioned full costume one-piece bathing suit in Annette Kellerman's era. And now we see the Olympic athletes wearing again the same. And I know that Dave Barney is going to discuss about this in his presentation. So you will really enjoy Dave's presentation because he's talking about this issue. So what is past, what was past is now fashion and new. And we see the same with this technique. It is old, like the photo says, but at the same time, now they have developed the Lucas device, which is a device that initiates compressions without any attempt from the rescuer's point of view. It's just like the defibrillator. There are defibrillators now that do not have even a single button. You just apply the patch onto the casualty's chest and it's doing all the work. The same is with Lucas device, which is the modern technology of what you see on this picture. The device is doing everything. You do nothing. In the Stewart method, slightly different technique. You can see how it works here. A little bit more complicated instrumentation. We see here that the medical thinking of this era has developed, so they are using equipment as opposed to what they were doing in the early past. Again here we use some instrumentation similar to the previous photo, so the people have started realizing that we need to do something. It's not just coincidence, we use this technique and it was successful. We need to improve our thinking of how to treat patients. This is possibly applicable to special population. The casualty had a heart attack while working, so I need to apply a specially designed method where the casualty is. With the current medical thinking, we know that we would take the casualty down and apply all the first aid and resuscitation techniques on the ground. But this is how they thought at this moment in time. Holger-Ninsfeld method, 1932, we apply pressure on the upper back of the casualty, and then we release this to initiate inspiration. So when you press, exhalation. When you release, inspiration. Van If, similar philosophy, you just go up and down for the two stages of breathing. Again, Emerson technique, you pull, exhalation, you leave the casualty lower down, inhalation. Inhalation. And then in 1950s, if I remember well, the American Red Cross came up and said, well, we need to do something different. So they started thinking about the mouth-to-mouth resuscitation technique. Now, well, this is another story. I've never said that before, but I'm going to share it with you. There is another technique that I have developed. No book is talking about this technique, but this came out after the mouth-to-mouth. When I was young, I was living with my family in a countryside area in a house, and accidentally I left the door open because I was furious to go to the kitchen to eat. So my little pet mouse found the opportunity to escape and fell in the river and almost drowned. So I had to do mouth-to-mouse resuscitation to revive my pet mouse. But you are not going to see this technique written in the symposium book. Written.
Did it work?
It worked, yes. So now, just recently, a few decades ago, we designed the defibrillation, and we identified that the chain of survival is very, very essential and crucial for first aiders to know in order to be effective for their the administration of their first aid. So we identified that it is very, very important to have early access to the incident to realize what's going on, then to have early life support, early cardiopulmonary resuscitation. No, to let the ambulance crew know that something is going on. So you make a call and they come as fast as possible. Then you do resuscitation. Then you do advanced life support and defibrillate the casualty, and then you have early admission to the hospital. So these are interlinked, very crucial things that need to be done. And then, finally, we came up with the defibrillation technique, which is very, very important, because we found out that by administering cardiopulmonary resuscitation, we are actually buying time. We cannot save the casualty by doing it. We just do not allow the heart to go on flat line, because this would be too late. There is a chaotic rhythm on the heart, which we call it VF, ventricular fibrillation. The heart goes and we want to keep this alive. If this will go flat line, it's too late. So with our resuscitation, we try to keep this still active, yeah? This chaotic sound, heart rhythm. And then the defibrillator will come and stop this chaotic rhythm, and hopefully will bring the heart back to the normal sinus rhythm, if we are lucky. So this is what is happening here. So, to discuss what we found. The resuscitation methods were designed for victims that needed help in various locations, with emphasis on those that occurred on or brought to land. All the resuscitation methods require one or two rescuers for their administration. Their application was not difficult, as you saw from the photos that I just showed you. The resuscitation methods were either empirically or scientifically designed. Empirically, it was in the early past, scientifically designed in the recent, in the early past, yeah, and scientifically designed in the recent present. The resuscitation methods were, in some methods, the stimuli needed to revive the victim was painful and sometimes dangerous, or at least disturbing. Remember the smoke technique. Yeah. In some techniques, respiration was attempted with various more or less sophisticated methods. In a small number of cases, have been mistakenly reported to be real resuscitation techniques by previous scholars. Because, for example, when we see biblical references, we see there that a midwife gave birth to a newborn. And she's talking about an animal, and a scholar believes that she revived a baby, a human baby. So the scholars did the mistake in understanding what the author of the past was talking about. And then one author is writing this, and then a second author copies the first, and we generate a whole literature who is talking about a non-human resuscitation attempt. Probably since prehistory, human beings have been helping and rescuing each other in times of danger and threat. Later in biblical periods, miraculous attempts that were mistakenly labeled as artificial exhale air ventilation were made to save apparently dead human and non-human victims. In antiquity, death was considered to be a special form of sleep. And early rescuers used painful stimuli to wake up the victim. Since then, several empirical and more scientific methods have been implemented for establishing standardized protocols and to revive those seeking emergency help. Several resuscitation methods have been used in the past. They were designed to be administered either by one or two rescuers to those in need or help in various locations, with emphasis on those occurring on or brought to land. Some of them were characterized by their intelligent design and sophisticated instrumentation. On the other hand, others appear amusing or brutal. In any case, they represent the medical thinking of this period. Overall, it seems that while in the early years methods were based on experience and coincidence, later techniques and their protocols were developed and were based on valid and scientific facts. Thank you very much for your attention.